Hey folks, this is Shock, and boy, are you guys in for a great Bible study. And I'm going to get right into it because we got a lot to cover. But before I do, let me show you some free things that you should get. Notice at the top of the page here on the left, it says shockonl.net. And when you go to that page, we've updated it. We've added some new free tools, free software, free games if you're into games and stuff, free audio debates. You can get a free audio Bible. See right here, it's kind of blinking on the right there. It says free audio Bible and stuff. You should click that and get a free audio Bible. It's great. It's an MP3 audio. I also strongly suggest Raul Ries MP3 audios. This guy is a pastor out here in California, and he is very powerful with the Spirit of God within his life. So he's great. And then Apologetics 315. If you want to get into more advanced apologetic study. Now, before we start the Bible study, I want to show you something right here where it says recent podcast. I just added what I think is the best live seminar on proof and evidence of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And let's click that, shall we? And I want to show you what you do. Now, when you click it, this page loads, and there's some different audios from our radio show and things like that, and here's all our archives, but it's going to say Live Seminar, Proof Jesus Resurrected. Excellent. And you could download it here, or you can just click play, and you could stream it here out of your speakers. But I want to tell you guys something. When I was an atheist, and I started researching the historic person of Jesus Christ and the resurrection claims, I started to be moved towards becoming a Christian. But then there were other things that caused doubt in my mind that he resurrected, and then I would kind of flip-flop back and forth. I was lukewarm. And then one day, you know, you just get tired of not deciding on the historicity of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. You just want to put the argument to rest one way or the other. So what I did is I said, look, I'm going to look at all the evidence for the historicity of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Is there proof of it? And is the proof solid enough to where it would cause me to leave atheism and become a Christian? And if it's not, then why should we believe in something that's just a lie or a fairy tale? And I was fine with that. If it was going to be a lie or a fairy tale, no rational person should believe in it. But if there's enough proof and evidence, and the best explanation of the facts of history, if they do show that Jesus rose from the dead, then I was going to be committed to be serious about this and honest and unbiased and become a Christian. Well, as you know, I left atheism, the lie and the fairy tale of atheism. And as I started studying apologetics more in the history of Jesus Christ and the resurrection claims, I realized that it is Christianity that has proof and evidence. You don't have to be a Christian based on blind faith. If you're an atheist, you are an atheist based on blind faith. But if you're a Christian, you can be a Christian also based on evidence. And we know that there's Christians that become Christians purely by the Holy Spirit moving within their lives, and that's certainly rational. You're rational to be a Christian even by that. But what I like about proof and evidence is you as a Christian, when someone says, why are you a Christian? Like Scripture says, we have to be prepared with an answer. And the best seminar I've ever heard in my life on the proof and evidence of the resurrection of Jesus Christ is right here. I put it on shockonl.net. You're going to go right here to shockonl.net, click music and podcast, see it on the top row here, and then this is the one you want to listen to. If you're a Christian, you need to have this in your arsenal of facts. So when you talk to someone like I used to be an atheist, you can give them some proof and evidence. If you got a piece of paper right now and you drew a line down the middle and you put all the proof and evidence on the side of Christianity and you put all the proof and evidence on the other side for atheism, Christianity decimates atheism. I became a Christian because of the proof and evidence. I left atheism because the lack of the proof and evidence. Sometimes I talk to my friends that are atheists and they'll say, well, I'm an atheist because I lack belief. And I like to tell them, no, you're not. You're an atheist because you're not educated. If you educate yourself, you will become a Christian. What I will tell you to do is be honest, like I am. And, you know, when I was an atheist, I went ahead and I said, you know what? I'm going to go where the proof and evidence lies. It lies on the side of Christianity. However, atheism has been found wanting in the scales and the balances. It has no proof and evidence. The proof and evidence is on the side of Christianity. So go to shakanow.net. We're going to start the Bible study now, but go to shakanow.net. Click music and podcast. I have tons of live seminars, live debates that I've had with sweet, cuddly, lovable, huggable atheists. And the last debate we just had, all compliments to the atheist. He admitted that Christianity won the debate and that atheism lost. He admitted that the proof and evidence is on the side of Christianity. You could say, to be an atheist, you have to believe it based on blind faith, because there is no proof and evidence for atheism. So let's start the Bible study. You guys are going to love this. Now, we're going to start on Luke. Let's start with the book of Luke. And we're going to start at Luke 5:12. So we're going to start off here. Jesus is walking, and as he's walking to another city, he sees a man full of leprosy, just a very dreadful, painful skin disease. I mean, you should look up the some of the symptoms and some of the problems you get when you have leprosy. It's pretty bad. So here we go. And it came to pass when he was in a certain city, Jesus Christ, behold, a man of leprosy, this guy's full of leprosy, sees Jesus and he falls on his face. So this guy bows down in front of Jesus and he's begging him, saying, Lord, if you will, you can make me clean. And he put forth his hand and touched him, saying, I will be clean. And immediately the leprosy departed from him. And there's this interesting pattern throughout Scripture where Jesus is charging people not to tell anybody about it, but to go directly to the priest and give up an offering for cleansing according as Moses commanded. So he wants the guy to go right to the priest and give up an offering for cleansing according to as Moses commanded. But what happens is, it says, but so much the more went there a fame abroad of him, and great multitudes came together to hear and to be healed by him of their infirmities. And he withdrew himself into the wilderness and prayed. Now, it came to pass on a certain day as he was teaching that there were Pharisees and teachers of the law sitting by, who were come out of every town of Galilee and Judea and Jerusalem, and the power of the Lord was present to heal them. And behold, men brought in a bed of a man who was a paralytic, and they sought a way to bring him and lay him before him. So picture this. Let's say you have a very good friend of yours. Maybe you grew up with him as a kid, and you love him like a brother, and he's a paralytic, and you know that you've been hearing that Jesus has this power to heal, but the crowds are so much, you can't even get close to Jesus. So look what these men do. They cause property damage. So check this out. And I want you to imagine this, okay? Jesus is in this house, and there's just, it's a crowded house. You know, you've probably been in a real packed house before. And it says, and behold, men brought in a bed, man who was a paralytic. They're trying to figure out a way to get in there. They just can't, right? And when they could not find by what way they might bring him in because of the multitude, they went upon the housetop. So they're like climbing up on the roof with this dude that's a paralytic. Now, can you imagine how scared you'd be if you're like a paralytic and they're lifting you up way up high on the housetop and you're, you know, And so what they start doing, these guys are bold. They're like, you know, they had a mission, they had a goal. They're like, he's gonna see Jesus. They start ripping up the roof. So I can picture Jesus there looking up as pieces of the roof are falling all over inside the house, you know, as these guys are doing property damage, right? And it says, and they let him down through the tiling with his bed into the midst before Jesus. Is that epic or what? So Jesus is probably looking up there like, as all this is going on, and so, you know, I bet everyone's like, wonder what Jesus is going to say. And it's interesting that Jesus doesn't rebuke them for ruining the roof. Look what he says. He says, it says, and when Jesus saw their faith, he said unto him, man, your sins are forgiven you. Now it's interesting that Jesus, he deals with the more crucial issue, which is the sins being forgiven. Notice he's not dealing with the physical aspect. You know, what good is it if you're a healthy atheist and you die and go to hell? What good is it if you're in witchcraft and you're healthy and you die and go to hell? What we all need, me included, we all need our sins forgiven, right? So Jesus has his priorities right. He does not deal with the handicap of this man yet, him being a paralytic. Notice he says, man, your sins are forgiven you. Interesting. Because only God can forgive sins, right? So Jesus is placing himself in the position of God. And I just think it's epic that the God that created the universe, the God that is responsible for your breath and my breath, if it's God's will for us to have another breath, we'll have it. If it's our time, he'll withdraw it. I mean, he holds our very breath in his hands, right? This God plants himself in the tently flesh of man in this epic, awesome person of Jesus Christ, the most famous person in world history. Listen, guys, there ain't a person in world history that has changed the world more than Jesus Christ. The most famous person in world history, ain't nobody changed the world more than him. And watch this, guys, this is great. Look at the love of Jesus Christ here, God in the flesh. He says, man, your sins are forgiven you. But the scribes and the Pharisees began to reason, saying, who is this who speaks blasphemies? Now, the Pharisees were right in a way if Jesus was not God. See, they knew the law, but Jesus is God, right? And even the Pharisees say in the next passage here, this sentence, who can forgive sins but God alone? But when Jesus perceived their thoughts, he answering said unto them, why reason you in your hearts? And look at the question Jesus asked them. And Jesus knows the answer, but he's pointing something out to them. It's like a hypothetical question. He says, look, which is easier to say, your sins be forgiven you, or to say, rise up and walk? Now, let's say you and I were standing in front of a paralytic. What's easier to do, to say your sins are forgiven, or to say, rise up and walk and heal this dude? Well, it's easier just to say the words, your sins be forgiven you, because anyone can do that. Anyone can say the words. But to show that Jesus does have the authority to forgive sins, what Jesus basically says here is, hey, look, you want proof and evidence? Check this out. This is what he's saying. I'm going to show you some stuff here. Jesus says, but that you may know that the Son of Man has power upon earth to forgive sins, he says this to the paralytic, I say unto you, arise, take up your bed, and go into your house. And immediately he rose up before them and took up on that which he lay and departed to his own house. And look what what this paralytic dude's saying. He's glorifying God on the way. You know darn well, my friend, you and I would do the same thing. You and I would have no pride or anything like that. We would not be embarrassed. We'd be shouting it through the rooftops. And in this case, they literally were shouting it through the rooftops because there's a big hole in the roof. And notice it, and they were all amazed, and look what happens, and they glorified God and were filled with fear. Notice, they know something's different here with Jesus. This fear doesn't mean that they're going around biting their fingernails, running from Jesus. It's like a respect with fear, saying, we have seen strange things today. They know something's different. And after these things, he went forth and saw a tax collector named Levi sitting at the tax office, and he said unto him, Follow me. Now, a lot of people will ask me, they'll say, Shock, you know, I don't get it. Jesus says, follow them, and people just follow him. Well, what a lot of biblical scholars are saying is, it's not like they never heard of Jesus Christ. And so as Jesus is moving through the town, what could be happening is Levi's witnessing this, and he's like, who's that? Oh, that's Jesus of Nazareth, the one that has this power to heal. So a lot of biblical scholars are saying it would only be natural that, of course, Levi has heard of Jesus Christ. You know, he's, notice it says in the previous passages, where were we at here? Notice, but so much more went there a fame abroad of him. So notice in Luke 5, where were we at, guys? Luke 5:15, notice the fame goes abroad and great multitudes start following him. So most likely Levi has heard of him, of course. And so Jesus tells Levi, follow me. And he left all. So Levi just leaves his tax office, closes up shop, rose up and followed him. So Levi's like, oh, this is awesome. You know, he knows Jesus has this power. And look what happens. Levi made himself a great feast in his own house. I mean, he's really honoring Jesus here. And notice the other tax collectors, they want to associate with Jesus Christ. And so, you know, Levi's a tax collector. He probably has lots of friends that are tax collectors. And so they're all sitting down with him. But the scribes and Pharisees murmured against his disciples, saying, why do you eat and drink with tax collectors and sinners? And Jesus answering said unto them, notice, he's saying basically that the tax collectors need forgiveness, you know, that they're sinners, right? And Jesus says this. He says, look, they that are whole need not a physician. If you're healthy, then why do you need a physician, right? But they that are sick, I came not to call the righteous, in other words, the arrogant, the people that aren't going to come to Jesus Christ anyways, but people like you and I, people that are honest enough and man enough, or if you're a female, woman enough, to admit that we're a sinner. Jesus says, I came not to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. And they said unto him, well, why do the disciples of John fast often and make prayers? And likewise, the disciples of the Pharisees, but you eat and drink. You know, so Jesus isn't going around fasting and doing all this stuff, you know. And look what Jesus says. He says, look, can you make the friends of the bridegroom fast while the bridegroom is with them? He's saying to them, look, this is a wonderful, marvelous thing that I am here. How can they fast when the bridegroom is here? I mean, it's very good news. And then he's talking about his death and resurrection, but the days will come when the bridegroom shall be taken away from them, and then they shall fast in those days. Now, let's kind of jump ahead here. That was Luke 5. Let's go to Luke 6. Now, and it came to pass on the second Sabbath after the first that he went through the grain field. So he's walking with his disciples, and the disciples start plucking the ears of the grain, and you rub them in your hands, you're able to like eat them. And certain of the Pharisees said unto them, and these Pharisees are like gnats, you know, they're always like harassing Jesus. Why do you do that which is not lawful on the Sabbath days? And Jesus answering them said, have you not read so much that what David did when he was hungry, and you could read this in the Old Testament, and they who were with him, how he went into the house of God and did take and eat the showbread, and gave also to them that were with him, which is not lawful to eat but to the priest alone? And look what Jesus says, he's referring to himself. This would be very arrogant, howbeit if it weren't true. Jesus says, look, the Son of Man is Lord also of the Sabbath. He's like, I own this thing. I'm the Lord of the Sabbath. And it came to pass also another Sabbath. So notice, now it gets to be more hostility towards Jesus. Seems like the scribes and the Pharisees are pretty much jealous. And so they're trying to make these accusations against him. And notice it says, but Jesus knew their thoughts, and because there was a man that had a withered hand. And notice Jesus says, rise up and stand forth in the midst. So picture this, all the Pharisees, scribes are there. They're wanting to catch Jesus and accuse him of something, breaking the law of God and stuff. And so the man with the withered hand, you know, he gets up and he's standing in front of everyone, right? So Jesus is saying to them, look, I will ask you one thing. Is it lawful on the Sabbath days, notice, to do good or to do evil? Now, if you're an atheist, you got a problem with this passage. Because when I was an atheist, the hypocrisy and bigotry of atheism is that they don't really believe that there is objective good or objective evil. They believe everything is subjective, but not with Jesus Christ. Notice Jesus is honest. He says, look, he's talking about there are things that are good and there are things that are evil. He's not saying it's subjective and he's not wishy-washy like atheists are. He says, look, is it lawful on the Sabbath days to do good or to do evil? To save life or to destroy it? And looking round about them, they're not really answering, right? They don't want to answer. So Jesus says, stretch forth your hand. And so he did so, and his hand was restored whole as the other. And look what happens. And they were filled with fury rather than glorifying God. Notice they're jealous. And they discussed with one another what they might do to Jesus. Can you imagine? Jesus Christ is there. This is a historical moment. God incarnate right here in the flesh. And rather than saying, this is awesome, I could have forgiveness of sins, I could have salvation, eternal life, they're more focused on themselves and they missed it. Hey, you know what? They're lost. Let's jump ahead here and check this out. This is really good. This is called the Beatitudes. And so what happens is Jesus is coming down. He's standing in the plain and the company of his disciples. And look what happens. And a great multitude of people out of all Judea and Jerusalem and from the seacoast of Tyre and Sidon who came to hear him and to be healed of their diseases. And they that were troubled with, notice, unclean spirits, and they were healed. And if you don't believe in demon possession, well, Jesus did. Jesus totally confirms the fact of demon possession. And notice, and the whole multitude sought to touch him, for notice, there went power out of him, and he healed them all. So you've got this massive group of people, and what will happen is if you ever watch some of the old movies on Jesus, they'll usually have the scene where everyone's kind of in this big field on the plain, and Jesus stands there and he starts just opening up his heart, and he's basically saying what God feels about them. What's God's motive? And the whole thing is that Jesus Christ going to the cross is God's love letter to us. He loved us so much that he was willing to die and for our sins, as a propitiation for our sins. So here's what Jesus says, and this is what God thinks of you and I. Notice, it's not judgmental. He doesn't want people to go to hell. If someone goes to hell, it's because they chose to do it. There's a saying that says hell is locked from the inside. Now, if you were guilty of being a sinner, and I'm guilty of being a sinner, and we were offered forgiveness of sins and salvation to accept what Jesus Christ did for us on the cross and repent and move closer to God and strive to do what he wants us to do, if we did that, if we move closer to God, our sins would be forgiven. But what if we just basically slap God across the face, slap this gift that he's handing us out of his hands? And by default, what Jesus says, there's passages in scripture where he says, look, your father is Satan. He actually says that. These are shocking things that Jesus have said. He talks about these people that reject him. He says their father is Satan. So you do have a father, and if it's not God, by default, it's Satan. So watch this. Jesus says, look, blessed be you poor, for yours is the kingdom of God. Blessed are you that hunger now, for you shall be filled. Blessed are you that weep now, for you shall laugh. Blessed are you when men shall hate you, and when they shall separate you from their company, and shall reproach you, and cast out your name as evil for the Son of Man's sake. Now, if you're a Christian, and in these stupid times of 2012, going on 2013, in our stupid age of political correctness, if you're a Christian like I am, and you say, well, political correctness can go to hell, I'm not going to be PC correct, I'm going to be JC correct. If you're a Christian, I know this passage applies to you in our stupid political correct times of the year 2012. I know that there are people that hate you for being a Christian. Hey, you know what? You're blessed. You are blessed. Look what Jesus says. He says, rejoice in that day. Every time someone curses you and they're calling you narrow-minded for being a Christian, rejoice, because remember Jesus said the road to salvation is narrow. He said, enter through the narrow gate. And look, he says, and leap for joy. You ever been so happy you leap for joy? Well, the next time someone's persecuting you as a Christian, just leap for joy because you're blessed. Notice, for behold, your reward, you're not going to get a little reward. You're not going to get a medium reward. Look, your reward is great in heaven. And remember Jesus said, you know, don't store up your riches where moth can corrupt it, and, you know, your reward is great in heaven. For in like manner did their fathers unto the prophets. But woe unto you that are rich, for you have received your consolation. Woe unto you that are full, for you shall hunger. These are some shocking things that people are saying. You know how the people are, you got these people like Richard Dawkins and Christopher Hitchens. Unfortunately, unless Christopher Hitchens repented, he's in hell right now. We're not happy about that. But notice, Jesus is talking about people like that. He says, you know how Richard Dawkins mocks Christians and laughs and stuff? Look what Jesus says. Woe unto you that laugh now, for you shall mourn and weep. Woe unto you when all men speak well of you. Notice, what does that mean? Well, they want the approval of men, not the approval of God. For so did their fathers to the false prophets. Now, this is really like for the Marines of Christianity. These are some tough lessons here. And not many people can do it. And I will confess, it's hard to follow this. But look what Jesus says. He says, but I say unto you who hear, love your enemies. Do good to them who hate you. So I do love Richard Dawkins. I hate what he does. And I did love Christopher Hitchens. Unfortunately, it's too late for him. He's in hell now. But you know what happened is Peter Hitchens, who is Christopher Hitchens' brother, Peter Hitchens saw how his brother Christopher was taking drugs, and his brother Christopher Hitchens dabbled in the perverse life of homosexuality. And Peter Hitchens said, you know what, I'm leaving atheism. And Peter Hitchens became a Christian. So let's be more like the good Hitchens, the wise Hitchens, Peter Hitchens, and less like the damned Hitchens, Christopher Hitchens. Let's learn from the foolishness of Christopher Hitchens, and let's learn from the wisdom of Peter Hitchens. Go look up Peter Hitchens, ex-atheist. He became a Christian. Now, here's another thing that's pretty difficult to do. Bless them that curse you, and pray for them who despitefully use you. And unto him that smites you on the one cheek, offer also the other. And he that takes away your cloak, forbid not to take your coat also. So this is for like the Marines of, I mean, you got to be a pretty epic Christian to be able to do this. Notice, give to every man that asks of you, and of him that takes away your goods, ask them not again. And as you would that men should do to you, do you also to them likewise. And then he has a good point here. He goes, look, for if you love them who love you, what thanks have you? For sinners also love you. really interesting, guys. Do you get what Jesus is talking about here? It'll jump out at you as you read it. There is a law of reaping and sowing that may not really exist in all fairness in this world, but it definitely exists in heaven, in spiritual realms. Everything we do here, like what Jesus is saying, there is a tally being made. There's a tally. There is a record of every little thing we do here. And this is what Jesus is saying is, look, if you've been wronged, if someone's wronging you and you're being wronged, God's going to make it right. I got to stop here and talk about this. A lot of people sometimes want to compare God to maybe someone like you and I. So let's say you and I are brothers, and I wrong you. I wrong you, and I offend you, and I do something wrong to you, and you say, well, that's okay, you know, you're forgiven, right? Just don't do it again. Well, that's what you and I do as humans, because we're not God. We're just sinners, right? You and I are sinners. But God does not just let sin go by idly. He's a very just God. He's got to judge sin. His nature is such where if something is wrong, let's say someone murders another person, and let's even say that no one finds out about it, God is going to be just. He's got to unleash his wrath on this evil. He's not just going to let it slide. Let's say you're a thief or a robber. He's going to judge that. Now, what's interesting is when Jesus was dying on the cross, one of the thieves and robbers was mocking Jesus and, you know, rebuking him, but the other one actually asked for forgiveness. He said that he was, well, let me finish my sentence. He asked for Jesus to remember him when he goes into his kingdom, and he also admitted that he was worthy of his punishment. And Jesus said, hey, look, I'm telling you the truth. Truly, I say to you, today you'll be with me in paradise. But he didn't say that to the other guy, you see. So someone's got to pay for our sins. Someone's got to do it. And believe me, we will pay for our sins. And people don't want to talk about it, but God is a God of wrath. He is a God of wrath, and he is a God of forgiveness. And what's interesting is, where does all this come together? Where does it meet? It meets at the cross. The way that you and I respond to the cross is going to determine if we receive the wrath of God or the forgiveness of God. That's the key. If we are willing to do what the wise thief on the cross did, and confess that we're a sinner, of course, and I know it's not a popular message because no one wants to admit that, you know, especially if someone has a low self-esteem of themselves, they don't want to admit that, but it all meets at the cross. The wrath of God and the love of God meets at the cross. It's like God is beckoning us to come to the cross, and with one hand he's holding back his wrath, which is going to come upon the earth. And with the other hand, he's beckoning us, please, you know, come to the cross. Scripture says that God does not delight in our destruction. Scripture says that God so loved the world that God gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever shall believe in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. But there's also the wrath of God. Remember in Sodom and Gomorrah, when the evil homosexuals were taking over the country and they were actually trying to rape the angels? And the sin of Sodom and Gomorrah finally just went over the line, and God sent these angels to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah, and the angels went and got Lot and his wife, and they were having to physically drag them out of the city because the angels said, look, you've got to go now. God's wrath is coming. You got to run for your life. So I would pray about this. I would pray about it, and definitely remember that audio I was telling you about when we first started. I'm telling you guys, I have absolutely no doubt in my mind whatsoever that Jesus Christ resurrected. Absolutely no doubt, based on the proof and evidence. When I was an atheist and I was researching it and stuff and I hadn't educated myself, I'll be honest with you, I had doubts. But then as I started looking at the proof and evidence, it's just so overwhelming. I have absolutely no doubt Jesus Christ resurrected from the dead. It's crystal clear when you listen to that. Now, let's continue. So Jesus says, but love your enemies and do good and lend, hoping for nothing in return, and your reward shall be great. Notice, he talked about rewards. Now, I know when I was an atheist, a lot of our atheist friends would say, well, you just think you're going to get a reward and stuff, and they'll mock that. But this is true. We do think we're going to get a reward. That's not why we do it. We do it out of love for God, but God loves us so much, he is going to give you rewards. I mean, that's what Jesus Christ is saying. And he says, your reward's going to be great, and you shall be the children of the highest. Notice, for he is kind unto the unthankful and to the evil. So notice, God's, like I was saying earlier, he's holding back his wrath. He's wanting people to come to forgiveness. He's wanting people to come to the cross, cast themselves at the mercy of Jesus Christ and his finished work on the cross. Notice Jesus says, be you therefore merciful as your Father also is merciful. Remember when, I believe it was David, and he was given an option to, because he had sinned against God, he was given an option to be punished for a time by men or punished for a time by God. Well, it's interesting. David was very wise. He said, I would rather be punished by God because I know God is merciful, but if man punishes me, he will have no mercy. So notice Jesus is saying, similar to what David was talking about, be you therefore merciful as your Father also is merciful. Judge not and you shall not be judged. Condemn not and you shall not be condemned. Forgive and you shall be forgiven. Give and it shall be given unto you. Good measure pressed down and shaken together and running over shall men give into your lap. For with the same measure that you measure it shall be measured to you again. And this is really interesting. You've heard the saying, the blind leading the blind. This is where it comes from. What Jesus is talking about is, how could someone that's not a Christian, someone that's lost and is not saved, how can they preach to you and I? He says, look, can the blind lead the blind? Why should we listen to people like Richard Dawkins, Sam Harris? Why should we listen to people that are not saved? They're blind. He says, shall they not both fall into the ditch? So the person leading you falls into the ditch, and so do you. And then what are they going to say? Oh, I'm sorry. It's too late then. And then he says, look, the disciple is not above his teacher, but everyone that is perfect shall be as his teacher. And you've heard about this too. Here's a good phrase. This one, when I was a new Christian, it really stuck with me, and even to this day it does. This is great. He says, and why behold you the speck that is in your brother's eye, but perceive not the beam that is in your own eye? You ever go to the hardware store and they have those big long two by fours, you know, big thick piece of wood? Well, what Jesus is saying is, look, your brother has this little tiny splinter in your eye and you're judging him, yet you're worse than him, and you have this big old 2x4 in your eye. Look what Jesus says here. He says, either how can you say to your brother, brother, let me pull out the speck that is in your eye? And look what Jesus says, when you yourself behold not the beam that is in your own eye. And then here's sweet, gentle Jesus. He doesn't mince words. He goes, you hypocrite. Cast out first the beam out of your own eye. In other words, you and I got to get fixed up first, right? We become Christians. We become saved. We get rooted and grounded in the Word of God. and then shall you see clearly to pull out of the speck that is in your own brother's eye. For a good tree brings not forth corrupt fruit, neither does a corrupt tree bring forth good fruit. If you're on YouTube and you're a Christian, it would be epic if you had a bunch of Christian videos on your channel. Now, that doesn't save you. If you're not a Christian, let's say someone's an atheist and they put a bunch of Christian videos on their channel, that doesn't save them, of course. We're saved through Jesus Christ. But whenever I hear someone that says they're a Christian and they're like, well, Shock, you know, you were talking about the wrath of God, and I feel uncomfortable about that. As a Christian, we should only talk about the love of God, you know? And I go, well, we should talk about both, because it's the truth. You know, Jesus spoke of hell more than anyone else in Scripture. And, you know, that's the truth, and we should also talk about the love of God. Let's talk about the whole message. But usually, what I have found, these people that are very critical of folks like you and I as Christians, and they want it to be done a certain way, when you go to their YouTube channel, they have absolutely no Christian videos there. They have the complete opposite types of videos. So, but sometimes what I found is you'll see people and you'll go to their channel, they'll have tons of Christian videos, and that's sort of like, that's their fruit, you see. You can tell. I mean, if someone's on YouTube and you're a Christian, oh, come on, guys, we got to have Christian videos on our channel. I mean, YouTube's like an atheist mecca. It's like Antichrist Central. You know, this is the perfect place to do it. You know what Scripture says, where Jesus says, you know, which of you has a lamp and you like put it underneath the bed or whatever? He says, no, you put it right smack dab in the middle of the room so it illuminates the entire room. So we're the light, the salt. Notice Jesus says, for every tree is known by its own fruit. For from thorns men do not gather figs, nor of a bramble bush gather they grapes. A good man out of the good treasure of his heart brings forth that which is good. And an evil man out of the evil treasure of his heart brings forth that which is evil. Notice, Jesus is saying, for of the abundance of the heart his mouth speaks. And he goes, why do you call me Lord, but you don't do the things which I say? So then he goes through this, and then we'll wrap it up, guys. And I really love you guys. I appreciate you going through this with me. He says, whoever comes to me and hears my sayings, that's you and I. That's you and I, hopefully, okay? He says, I will show you whom he is like. So this is what you're like if we hear Jesus saying, and we also do them. He is like a man who built the house and dug deep. Notice, I'm over here by Los Angeles, about 20 minutes away, and you can always tell how high the buildings are going to be. Like, if it's going to be a real high building, it's going to be a deep foundation. You could tell. So notice Jesus saying he's like a man who built the house and dug deep. It's going to be a sturdy house, you see. Solid foundation, and laid the foundation on a rock. And when the flood arose, the stream beat vehemently upon that house and could not shake it. Unshakable, for it was founded upon a rock. But he that hears and does not is like a man without a foundation, built a house upon the earth, against which the stream did beat vehemently. And look, and immediately it fell, and the ruin of that house was great. So, we all got one life to live here on this planet. If you've only got one life to live, why not live it as a Christian? It's epic. I love every single day of existence as a Christian. Even my bad days are good. Because you know what's really epic about being a Christian, guys, is I have come to learn the difference between joy and happiness. Happiness is something that you have only when you got a lot of money, or when your health's good, or when business is doing good, or you got a good job or whatever, and it's fleeting. But joy is something that's it's really spiritual. Joy is something like Jesus said. He said, your joy will be full and nobody can take it away. I know the difference between happiness and joy. So God bless you guys. Don't forget to go to shakanow.net. Listen to the proof and evidence seminar that Jesus Christ rose from the dead. Guys, look, this is real. This is real. This is truth. This isn't like some man-made religion like atheism, Hinduism, Buddhism, Islam. This is real. Most famous person in world history. No one has changed the world more than Jesus Christ. Get yourself the free audio Bible. Radically, dramatically change your life. I'd say, especially now going to the year 2013, we're in for a roller coaster ride, guys. Dig that foundation deep. God bless you guys. I love you. Have a great week.